I'm going to present your Shop Invader. So who am I? I'm Sébastien Beau. I'm co-founder and CEO of Acquation France. I'm an initial contributor on the connector of Magento and PrestaShop. And I am the creator of Shop Invader. And I have done a lot of contribution in the OCR. So we are going to start with a quick reminder of what is Shop Invader for newcomer. And then we're going to talk about what is a Jamstack and why Jamstack is something interesting and what is the impact on Shop Invader of this kind of new solution that we can use for Shop Invader. So we are going to talk about the roadmap of Shop Invader. So first, what is Shop Invader? Shop Invader, so what is Shop Invader? Shop Invader is a full open source e-commerce solution for Odoo. It has a powerful search support with Elastic and Algolia, because if you do search, if you do faceting, you have specific tools that handle a lot of tricky points like misstepping or synonymous or stuff like that. So these tools are really dedicated for searching product or category or blog post on your website. Shop Invader have a clean implementation of the storage of image and media. So you can use by default CDN to share your images, your media from all over the world. And one thing that is really important is that we want to have a stable REST API between Odoo version. So when you migrate Odoo, we don't want to break everything. We want to keep things compatible between several versions of your website. And something that is really important, it's a headless e-commerce. And it's something that we talk again just after to explain this concept of headless. So the architecture. Basically, you have Odoo. We have done a lot of module on top of Odoo. And this module, you have a generic module in the OCF for the storage of images. You have generic module in OCF for search engine connector. And you have a generic REST framework to build a REST API on top of Odoo. So we have this generic module, and then you have the Shop Invader project hosted on GitHub, where we use all of this brick and in order to build the solution. So something that you have to understand is that basically every feature is an Odoo module. And then you have your, for example, if a user navigates on your website, is going to request currently locomotive. So it's going to request locomotive for a web page. This page, for example, if it's a product page, it's going to be read. Locomotive will read the product information in Elastic or Algolia. And then it will render this page to the customer, the visitor of the website. And images will be directly downloaded from Amazon. So basically, if you navigate on this kind of website, you don't do any request to Odoo. You only do requests when you interact to Odoo. So when you add a product to your cart, remove a product to your cart, update your address, consult your history. So the main point is that basically, Shop Invader is just a huge, big API on top of Odoo and a high-level API so that a CMS can build e-commerce, can have e-commerce feature by just interacting with Odoo. So this is the main point of the current Shop Invader architecture. Everything is on Odoo side, and then you have a CMS like Locomotive with a plugin for a ShopInvader plugin, so it can interact with Odoo, with Elastic to consume this extra services. And something important is that ShopInvider is an headless e-commerce. So every ShopInvider module are an Odoo module. So it's basically an Odoo module, nothing more, nothing less. It's just an Odoo module. And if you take a look to the number of line of code, basically you have quite all of the code is on its Python code and XML code. And the plugin on Locomotive size is not really big. It's a small plugin. So what is Jamstack? The main concept of Jamstack is to really to split the front and the back end, because you can have a lot of front end technology. And if you look at all of the new stuff built on top of Vue and React, you have a Nuke.js framework with based on Vue.js. You have a Next framework based on React. You have a lot of front end framework and the JavaScript world goes really fast. The front-end world goes really fast. You have a lot of new stuff every year. And the idea of the Jamstack is to separate the data from with the front-end. So you have the back-end for a CMS. You can have a CMS for the back-end. And in this CMS, you will only put data. No team, no stuff like that, no specific front-end stuff. It's only a back-end for storing data. And then you have a front-end technology, and you can pick whatever technology you want to build your website. And the main concept of Jamstack is pre-rendering websites. One idea is that if you really want to deliver your website really fast, you can pre-render it. So basically, your website will be just a static file. So you can render every page of your website, pre-render every page, and then you will put this static file on different server, Nginx server, Apache server, and stuff like that. And then another concept is the consummation of API. So if your website needs to add a specific feature like a form, then instead of using a traditional CMS where you have this form built on this CMS, in this case you just have a JavaScript that will send this form to a specific API endpoint. So this is why every dynamic feature is done with JavaScript, so you interact with different API. And why Jamstack? If you can go to the Jamstack org, Jamstack is really a concept of doing stuff. It's not a specific technology, front-end technology. It's really a concept of doing stuff. And the point is that if you do static pre-rendered static website, hacking is really hard, because every static page is just served by Nginx or Apache, and you don't have a lot of entry points. When you do a request, you are not going to request to a CMS that will request stuff to a database and a lot of things. You just get a static file. And scanning is something really easy, because as it's a static file, you can put this static file all around the world, and you can have several server in different place. And for the performance, it's just serving a static file. So basically just a matter of some milliseconds, and it's really, really, really fast. And for the developer experience, this stack, every front-end can take whatever technology you want. It don't depend on a specific CMS or a specific tool. It pick what you want to use. If you prefer Vue.js, you can use Vue.js. If you prefer React, you can use React. It doesn't, we don't care. Yeah, because if you choose in all of the case, you are going to consume the same API and the same data from the CMS. And for the maintenance and the uptime, it's really great, because when you serve static file, basically your production server is just a Linux server with Nginx and nothing more. So the maintenance work is really, really slow. And if you want to use a hosting service that already give you the possibility to serve static file, then you can use it directly. So you can have more information on the Jamstack website. And so I'm going to give you some case of what is, or how does it look like with Jamstack stuff. So for example, you can pick whatever CMS you want. So you have a lot of CMS. You have a Strapi, a Ghost, Netlify CMS, Directus. You have a lot of CMS. So in this CMS, you are going to fill your data. So you're going to create a new blog post pages. You're going to create, a new banner for your home page. You're going to create different block of stuff that you want to publish to your website. And then you're going to pick one of a static site generator. So you have a lot of possibility. And this static site are going to get the content from the CMS, render it, and generate the page for your end user. So kind of real case. So you can, for example, use Strapi. So in Strapi, the user are going to edit the content in a headless CMS. So if they use a web interface to edit the content, you can create a new blog post, new pages, whatever they want. Then you have the developer that can use, for example, Nuxt.js, but it can be whatever framework you want to use. And with this framework, they're going to consume Strapi data to build, for example, the blog post, the pages, the home page, and stuff like that. And then you have, the framework, you can launch the generation of the website, and then you can deploy all of the pages to Nginx server. So you can just do rsync to publish the pages on several Nginx server. And then when user interact, they just read a static page like in the 19s. Yeah, it's really something, just a static HTML page, nothing more, with JavaScript, but it's just a static page. And when you want to add some dynamic feature, like for example, you want to manage lead, or you want to manage a support stuff or stuff like that, you can add extra services, and these microservices can be consumed by Nuxt if there is some extra content that you want to publish to your website. And then also end user can interact to these microservices to post a formula, to post stuff. And if you look at this picture, basically it's really look like what we have done with Shop Invader. So one thing interesting is that supporting the Jamstack is basically not a lot of work, because it's already the architecture of Shop Invader project. So it's not changing everything and breaking everything in Shop Invader. It's just fixing, improving some stuff in Shop Invader to be able to use Shop Invader with a Jamstack in the Jamstack way. So if we project to your Shop Invader in this case, what we're going to do is that, like before, Odoo with search engine module are going to push product, category, brand, all of this information in Elastic and Algolia. Then with the site generator, we can pre-render all of the product page, all of the category page, brand page, and all of this. We can pre-generate all of this, so you can pre-generate all of the website and publish it to Nginx. For the images, it will be the same. So you can push the images in whatever CDN you want. And the end user will consume these images. And for the REST API, then you can directly the customer can directly interact to the REST API without passing through the locomotive like before. So it's using Shopping Rider with this stack, it's something really natural. And it's really, really interesting because you can have a full e-commerce website pre-rendered. So the performance are just incredible because when you go to a pages, you don't request a server that will request a database that will retrieve some information, build the page, and then render the page. You just get your static page. So in terms of performance, it's just the best. You always eat cache. You don't even need cache because it's already a cache. So this is why we should add this support to Shopping Rider. But the first thing is that we will build faster website, and it will be really the fastest website we can ever build because it's just a static file. So we can do better than this. It will be the best solution for having the best fast website. And this also performance have an impact on SEO because Google, when Google index your website, if it's require him a lot of time, it will index less pages of your website. So if you have a fast website, it will increase your score and it's better. And also for the user experience, because if you navigate from whatever place you are, having a quick response of the website is always something better. It will be better for security, scalability, so all of Jamstack advantage. And being pure headless, I think it's really important because we will not depend on any front-end technology. In 5 years, I can predict in the future what will be the best front-end technology. JavaScript have a lot of things, everything move really fast, and depending on really one front-end technology, I don't think it's a good idea because we cannot predict what will be the future. So being pure headless will give us the possibility to switch of front-end, and even we will be multicultural. So maybe we have part of the community that will prefer to use Vue.js, other people who prefer to use React.js, maybe other people want to use Go framework for building a static website or whatever. So everybody can use whatever front-end they want, and we will be multicultural. It's better for being more resilient, to have better more innovation, and also it gives you the possibility to be multi-interface, because maybe sometimes you want to build a micro website for a specific occasion. Then okay, you have your main website, you want to create a quick website for 2 months for selling specific stuff. You can do it. You consume the same API. It's just building a simple front end, and you can do it really fast. You can, for example, if you want to do a specific mobile apps, you can do it, and you will just consume the same Shopping Rider headless API. So all of this give us the possibility to be always here in 10, 20 years, because all of the code we do will not change in the future, because all of the Odoo module are pure headless API. So what we build now is still valid in 5, 10, 20 years. And the documentation is really simpler, because for the Shopping Rider part, it's just an auto-documented API. So when we design an API with the Cerberus, we design a schema with Cerberus to validate the input and the output, And this schema will generate the documentation. So we always have a up-to-date documentation, and it's clean and perfect. And for the front-end tech, you can take whatever technology you want, and you can read their own documentation. And there is nothing magic. It's just reading generic documentation of the front-end you tech you use, and reading the auto-documented Shopping Radar API. So what is the roadmap for the version 40 and the next version? We want to do several things. First, we need to add user authentication, because now the authentication was specific to locomotive. Authentication was done in locomotive. We want to add offline cards. We have some challenge with static site generation. We want to be able to build more OCA REST services. I'm going to explain why. And we want to improve also the documentation. So user authentication, we already have done some job. So basically now you can use Shopping Radar services with or without locomotive. So you can have, we have done JOT authentication. So you still have API key for locomotive case, but you can have JOT authentication. We want to, so the idea is that you have a module for the authentication, and then you need to have the process for creating the account, logging and stuff like that. And for this, we will provide three possibilities. First possibility is to use an external tool like KeyClock, and then you connect to KeyClock. We have an account synchronization with Odoo. And then you connect to KeyClock and you're logged to your website, and you can use whatever feature that KeyClock provides. We also want to provide a basic, simple authentication on Odoo, but based on REST partner. So you will have a sign-in and a reset password and stuff like that based on the REST partner. So it gives you the possibility, if you don't want to use KeyClock, then you can just install the module for using account based on REST partner, and then you can access to the REST API for every customer that are linked to REST partner. And we also want to provide a notification based on REST user. So if you have some internal application or stuff like that, then being logged with a REST user gives you the possibility to access to the REST API with this user. This is different kind of way to have the user authentication. And we still support the locomotive authentication. It's just adding new way to authenticate the user. Offline card. What is offline card? The idea is that, for example, if Odoo is down, you still want to add product in your card, reduce the quantity, increase the quantity, and also, having an offline card give an impression that the website is super fast. Because every time you click on something, the product is immediately added in your card. So you see on your web page that your card have changed, the quantity of your card have changed, and stuff like that. So it's really immediate, it's instant. And then in background, we will push this information to So what we are going to support for this offline card, we are going to support adding a product, removing a product, updating an item. But we don't plan to have a full process. So when you do the checkout, if you do the payment, if you want to fill your addresses, the stuff like that, you need to be online. This is something important, because if you doing this part offline is really, really hard. And at the end, it's not a big added value, because you don't have a lot of a loss of customer for at this stage. And how we are going to do this? The first thing is that we're going to build a generic JavaScript lib, so it will be independent of whatever framework we use for building the front end. So you can use this lib with a locomotive case. You can use this lib with a Jamstack case or whatever you want. So the idea is that every time you do something, you add a product, remove a product, this is our transaction. And all of these transactions are sent to Odoo. And when all these transactions have been consumed by Odoo, Odoo returns us the state, the last state of the cart. So we'll add a new endpoint to the cart endpoint on the API, and we still have the existing endpoint. So we don't break anything on the current implementation. So it's a new endpoint for this specific feature. And we have done some public specification for this. Static site generation. We have done some prototype of this. So basically, we have tried to generate a website with 5,000 products and 10,000 variants. And generating a full website with category and stuff like that, it's just done in 5 minutes in local. So it's not really long to generate a website with 10,000 variants. Is not really big, but it's not really small. So it starts to be a normal website. And so we're going to work on this and improve this, because I think we can improve a lot with the performance, but already 5 minutes is not so big. And what we want to do, the challenge is the possibility to have a partial generation. So if you want to, if you add a 100 product, you only want to update the pages of this product and not all of the catalog. And the same if you change the content on CMS part, you want to generate only some specific patch. So we are going to work on this partial generation. It's possible. It's not really easy, but it's totally possible. You can also have, for example, if you have to with static website, for example, you generate your website one time per day, and so if the quantity, the stock quantity, when in the static page is not the right one, because you generate this morning, and now maybe the stock have changed. So the idea is that when you load the page, you can refresh some static some information like the stock, the prices or stuff like that, and update this. So you can even if only static file as it's built on JavaScript, you can refresh some information from Elastic or Algolia. So you can update some information without needing a server side work. If you don't want to use static site generation, it's not an issue. If you can still use a framework like Nuke.js or Next.js or even WordPress, and you can build on top of Shop Invader API. So static generation is something that we want to push because it's going to give you some crazy performance, but it's not something mandatory. You can even still use Locomotive. And OKRS services. Why we want to build OKRS services? Because there is some, for example, you have case where you have an existing, you have your existing website, and you want to add the lead management or help desk management on your website. And for this, lead management or help desk management don't depend on ShopInvader stack. So the idea is that we must build REST services directly in OCA for some generic module. So for example, so how you're going to do this, you first do a generic module for adding services. So services are endpoint, are services that you're going to consume through a controller. And you're going to mount these services in a specific module. And then you can consume your endpoint. And you have an example of for the help desk. So all of the logic of the services are done in the OCR module. So you have a PR there. And then on ShopInvader, we just mount these services in a specific endpoint. So step by step, you're going to see more and more OCR REST module that will appear in different place for help desk, lead, and stuff like that. So even if you don't want to use ShopInvader, you can, on your existing website, add a basic formula that will send this information to your Odoo. So I'm going to have a little some question that I have in mind that maybe you can ask. So for the documentation, basically, as we're going to be focused on headless, basically, we will have a great up-to-date documentation, because every time you install a module, you will have a dynamic documentation for all of our endpoints. And we already have done all of the work for the input. So every time you want to send a request, you have the parameter that you have to send. But the response needs to be documented. It's not yet the case. And we are going to work on this. If you ask, do you are going to still use and maintaining Locomotive plugin? Yes, we have customers that use it. We have project under construction, and we plan to upgrade their Odoo without changing their website. So we are still maintaining this. Just what we want to as we have already a mature e-commerce solution, I think it's time to work more on the front-end part and give us more possibility. Because on Odoo side, we already have a huge stack, a strong stack with a great contributor. So now it's more to we have to spend more time on the front end part and give us more possibility, and having more new company that can do website because they know how to use Vue.js, React, or whatever stuff. Although it's mandatory to use Jamstack or static generator, it's not mandatory, as we are going to be pure and less. You can use whatever stack you want, even WordPress if you want. You can use whatever you want. The idea is that you're going to consume services on Odoo, and you can use whatever you want. So I would like to thank you. And also would like to thank Axon, Camp2Camp, and Forgeflow for the contribution they do on the project. It's a huge pleasure to have contributor and to have a lot of great ideas, because all of this company really invest time and share a lot of really, really good ideas. So I want to thank them and thank also you for listening us.
Well, thanks, Sebastian, for an awesome update on where Shop Invader's at. But we've had a few questions coming in the chat. Okay. I think we've probably got time to answer one of them. I'd suggest that for Hendrik asked about the live demo, maybe take that one there over to Discord, and potentially we could use one of the discussion topics tomorrow. But a question has actually come through twice. How difficult would it be to migrate an existing WordPress or WooCommerce website over to what you've done with Shop Invader and static site generation?
For example, if you have a WordPress, you have two possibilities. If the customer have a lot of content on the WordPress and don't want to use another tool for feeding the data, one thing you can do is that you can you have plugin on WordPress that make WordPress headless. So basically, you can build a static website with Nux, Next, or whatever you want, and consume the data of the CMS of WordPress and consume the API of Odoo. So for the customer, it can be maybe an easier migration if you have a lot of content on WordPress and don't want to change too many things. But and in any case, if I'm migrating an existing e-commerce, the huge work is rebuilding the website part, because you're going to change the theme, you're going to change the stuff in the cart, process. So it's changing the technology, you need to, for you, you're going to redo a new website. So it's also a good time for improving the design, improving the user experience and stuff like that.
Excellent. Thanks, Seb. Let's check if we got any more questions. But right now we've got lots of thanks for your presentation. Sounds like everyone is really, really interested. Hold on a second. I'm getting feedback from my wife sitting behind me now tuning in. Okay, one last question. How do features like filtering products work with Jamstack, since it's dynamic content based on the query of the user?
Basically, if I go here, one thing that you have to understand is that here, customer will, when you have if you type the URL of a product page, you are going to get the static page from the product. If you go to a category, for example, you download the category, and the category you have faceting on the left of the pages, and when you click on different filter, you are not going to ask a new page on Nginx. You are just going to request Elastic, and then dynamically in your browser you are going to see the filter applied. So all the faceting is just requesting Elastic. And if you take a look on what we have done before with Locomotive, it was the same case. When user do faceting, it directly requests Elastic. It don't use Locomotive for the faceting, for the search, for the filtering, all of this. So it's basically the same as before. Faceting is just requesting directly Elastic or Algolia if you use Algolia.
Excellent. Well, thanks, Seb. That's all the time we've got for questions today. If people do want to continue with questions, as I say, go to the Track One Track on Discord. Are you going to drop over there maybe a little bit later, Seb? And certainly, I think a lot of people would be interested in seeing a live demo. I don't know where you're at there, but we can talk about that a little bit later.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks, Seb.
Bye.